excited. Now I'm jealous. I'll be honest a little bit. Some of you got naps this afternoon. That's not very fair. Amen. But you know, that's it. Amen. Somebody told me they got two, and I think somebody else said they got three naps today. That's just sad. But it's good to be in God's house tonight. It's good to be in our stage of worship again. It's an amazing thing that so many people, they almost dread having to go to church. And I'm like, get your heart right and you'll love going to church. Because we get to do something that other people don't get to do. And that's come worship the holy name of Jesus Christ. And it is good to be in His house. Now, it's good to be in Evansville, too. I live in Newburgh, just outside of Evansville. Don't hold that against me.
Sorry.
I know. If you won't hold that against me, I won't hold that some of you were born in Kentucky against you. So. But as we're looking at this, you know, I'm over there in Newburgh, and I kind of like this area. We've been down here for almost 2 years now. And I'll be honest, one of the really cool things about being in this area, especially in the spring and the summer, is that Holiday World's right down the road. I really like that. That's really cool. And some of you are saying, eh, but I like it. I've got two young kids. We like going over there and like riding the rides. It's a great thing and a lot of fun. But there's one ride that I absolutely despise. I just hate it. And it's the bumper cars. Now, some of you are going to think because I get hit. No, I like the bumper cars because I like to hit people, amen. So I enjoy that. But the part of the bumper cars I don't like is, have you ever tried to steer one of those things? You like turn it and it goes this way. You turn it and it goes that way. And you just spin it around and it just goes all crazy. I mean, it doesn't really matter where you turn it. It's going to go where it wants to go. And you can't really turn it specifically because I might like these people over here, but there's a knucklehead over here I want to get. And for the life of me, I can't get it to turn to go to his way to hit him. So I just don't like that ride very much. But I got to thinking about that. This morning we talked a whole lot about turning. And we said that revival, the first step of revival is repentance, is turning. But I want you to understand, we're not talking about turning like in that bumper car. Somebody or some people, when they talk about turning, they're just trying to turn anywhere. They know this isn't the right way, so they're going to try this. And they'll realize it's not right, so they'll try that. And they'll keep trying, and they're just kind of spinning their wheels. But what we talked about this morning was not just a turning, but a specific turning to something.
Amen.
It's turning from the world to the Word to God.
Amen.
You understand? That's what revival is. True revival is marked by turning to something, turning to God, and turning to God's Word. Now, I told you to really start revival in your heart. It begins with repentance. But it's almost always marked with a fanatical, radical trust in God. It's interesting. Whenever you see people who are truly on fire for God, they just simply believe that God can do anything. Imagine that. Imagine that. And what it would look like for us to have complete and utter faith in God. And that's what we see as we look tonight back in 2 Kings. And we're going to be back in chapter 18 of 2 Kings. And we'll jump over to 19 a little bit tonight. And we're going to go back and look at Hezekiah's song. And we're going to see that some of the greatest failures in life are due to the fact that people don't have faith in Jesus. They don't have faith in God. Some of you have faced failures in your life, and one reason that you faced those failures is because you didn't have the faith that you needed to simply to do it God's way and to trust that God was going to work it out. Tonight, we're going to see that Hezekiah has that faith. He shows us an example of what it looks like not just to repent, but to have faith. You understand, Hezekiah realized that it's one thing in good times to go to the house of God and worship Him, but it's something totally different to have faith in God when the enemy is at the gates. And that's where Hezekiah, we find him at tonight as we look at this passage of Scripture. And I want you to see this. His trust in God brought him great reward. But here's what I want you to remember through all this tonight. Hezekiah had faith in God, and God rewarded that. But it wasn't just Hezekiah that reaped those benefits. The entire nation was rewarded through the faith of Hezekiah. And friends, you need to hear me and hear me well tonight. When you put your faith in God, it's not only you that will benefit that the rewards of that faith. Those around you, your family, your friends, they also will benefit from that. They will receive the blessing that you receive from God. It will be an overflow. See, that's how great our God is. Our God just overflows those blessings from us on all those around us. And when he put his trust and God, God didn't give him victory. You know, that's one thing. God could have given him victory. God gave him an impossible victory. No way it could happen. But God gave it to him. One last thing before we begin tonight, before we go to 2 Kings, I want to remind you what Jesus says over in Mark chapter 9, verse 23. The words of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, he said this, "Everything is possible for him who believes." Amen. So friends, my challenge to you tonight is simply, do you believe? Do you trust in God? Let us look in 2 Kings chapter 18, and we want to read verses 5 and 6. And these are going to be kind of our reminder springboards to get us started tonight. And as I said, we'll go a little bit deeper as we go tonight. But chapter 18, beginning of verse 5, says, "Hezekiah trusted in the Lord God of Israel. Not one of the kings of Judah was like him, either before him or after him. He remained faithful to Yahweh and did not turn from following him, but kept the commands of the Lord that the Lord had commanded Moses." Once again, I invite you to go to prayer as we seek wisdom and guidance from the Holy Spirit tonight in God's Word. Father, we just ask you that you reveal to us the truth of where we are in our walk with you. Father, some of us, we still haven't got the message. Some of us still need to feel the Spirit's conviction upon us. Father, others of us have heard that conviction and we're trying to respond. And maybe we're not really sure exactly how to. Father, we need wisdom. Your word tells us if we lack wisdom, if anyone lacks wisdom, all he has to do is ask. And Father, tonight we just ask for your wisdom. We ask for the power of your Spirit to be upon us. Father, that your Spirit would lead us in this time of devotion, in this time of study. And Father, let us see what you would have us see. Let us hear what you would have us hear. Father, more importantly, let us do what you would have us do. Father, Christianity is not a religion. It's a lifestyle. Let us understand that. Let us embrace it. Father, let us realize the greatest truth of that lifestyle is that we can trust you in all things. In Christ's name, by the power of the Spirit, we ask these things. Amen.
Amen.
Tonight as we begin, as I said, we're looking here at 2 Kings 18. And the message I want you to see right at the beginning is that God does not turn. God does not turn. You see, I can change. Last year I was a different man than I was today. And if you were to present me a solution or a problem last year, I might have given you a different answer into how I would look at it this year. Because as I grow up, as I get more mature, as I gain, hopefully in age, wisdom, I began to look at things differently and I had a different perspective. And depending on where I was last year when I was presented that problem, I may very well respond differently this year. So you understand, you're not necessarily going to get the same answer every time you come to me because I'm different. I change. But God does not turn. God does not change. Right. So we can be guaranteed when we go to God what we're going to get because we can know who He is and what He is about. And that's what Hezekiah shows us this evening. As we see, Hezekiah has made a decision. It says in verse 5, he trusted in the Lord God of Israel. He chose to follow God. You understand, God does not make robots. God does not coerce people. God has simply laid down a choice, a decision for us. Over in the book of Luke and Mark, both, Jesus says, if anyone decides to come after me, let him lay down his cross. Or let him take up his cross, lay down his life, deny himself, and follow me. But here's what I like about that. He says, if anyone decides to come after me. If anyone wants to follow me, God, Jesus doesn't say you better follow me. He says I want you to and I hope you will, but it's your choice. You understand, whether we trust God or not is not dependent on God, it's dependent on us. God has made himself trustworthy and opened his heart up to us, but it's open for us to embrace it. Amen. We have to make that decision. And Hezekiah here, he chooses to follow God. And you know what's so remarkable about this? Is that he didn't have a godly example to follow.
That's right.
He didn't have a godly example. Think about it. We talked this morning about his father was one of the most evil, immoral kings to ever rule. Hezekiah did not have a godly example. His father had, in essence, exiled all the priests, all the religious leaders of the day. They weren't around. Hezekiah didn't know what it meant to follow God completely, but he knew in his heart that the life he was living wasn't right. And he says, I want to follow God, whatever that means. see through his life, he has to figure some things out. He doesn't know everything. And that's the beauty of it. God does not say, find out everything, learn everything, then come follow me.
That's right.
God says, come follow me, and I will walk with you every step of the way.
Amen.
And that's what Hezekiah does. He makes the decision. He says, I'm going to follow Jesus. I'm going to follow God. Now, here's what I want you to see. A lot of us, we put our faith in things. We go outside on most days and we put our keys in the car and we turn that key and we expect that car to crank. And if that car doesn't crank, we get cranky, amen? That's the reality of it. We expect it to. And if that car doesn't crank, guess what? That ruins our day, doesn't it? The battery's dead. Well, our calendar's just out. Our schedule's out. We just ruined our day. How could that have happened? If somebody we trust has told us something and we find out that they were not telling us the truth, it just ruins our day, doesn't it? It just disappoints us. It discourages us. For some of us, it depresses us. Friends, you understand? People and stuff shake the peace that you have. Your trust is misplaced.
Right.
Friends, you understand? People say, people tell me, they just say that I'm living my little bubble. You know, I'm like that boy. He's got a little plastic bubble that just rolls around everywhere on my big house. The reality is they say I live in a bubble because I just always look on the bright side of things. And I just don't see any barriers. I don't see any walls. And they say, well, no, Dale, you must be on something. And I say, yes, thanks Jesus. But the reality is they say, how can you always be so happy? Happiness is something that's fleeting. For me, I think that that's almost an excuse. I know that happiness is, quote, temporary because it's based on circumstances. And so they say, well, we want to have joy. We want to always be happy, but we want to have joy. But I don't understand why we can't always be happy. See, the reality is, if you're basing it on the circumstances of this world, you're right, it's going to be fleeting. But if you're basing it on the circumstances of your relationship with Jesus Christ, it's eternal.
Right.
And friends, here's the reality of it. If God is for us, who can be against us?
Right.
What does it matter if the car doesn't crank? I'm going to live in heaven for all eternity, amen? I mean, what do those things really matter in the scheme of things? And friends, that's where Hezekiah was. Hezekiah makes a decision. And friends, I want you to know tonight, happiness and peace is all about a decision. So I challenge you, make the right one. That's what Hezekiah did. I love Benjamin Franklin. I love going back and reading about Benjamin Franklin. Very wise man, much smarter than I will ever be. But Benjamin Franklin had all these little pithy sayings and everything else. And he was giving a speech one day about the Constitution as they were preparing to roll out the Constitution. And he was talking about that part of the Constitution that talks about that every individual has a right to pursue happiness. The pursuit of happiness. And he was talking about that. And people began to heckle him. They began to make fun of him. They began to question him and say, well, how in the world can you guarantee our happiness? How in the world can you say, I'm going to be happy? And he looked at him and he said, well, you, my friend, probably will never be happy. And he said, but here's what the Constitution does. And here's what he said. He said, the Constitution only guarantees us the right to pursue happiness. You have to catch it yourself.
Amen.
Friends, God has opened up his heart. He's opened up his love. And he says, it's yours. But you have to make that choice to choose it. You have to make that decision. Hezekiah made that decision. And we see this decision was qualified through his devotion. Look down in verse 6. It says there in verse 6, it says, he remained faithful to Yahweh and did not turn from following him, but kept the commands the Lord had commanded Moses. In other words, he did exactly what he was supposed to do. He followed God. He didn't stop following him, even in the bad times. Friends, I see a lot of people, oh, they get excited, they get fired up, and they say, oh, I'm going to change my life for God, I'm going to live for God. And they do that as long as it's easy. But the moment life gets hard, life gets difficult when they give up on God. And they say, well, why should I keep doing it? It's not working. I had a drug dealer come into my office when I was pastor up in Indianapolis. And he came and sat next to me or across from me. He and I, it would be a long story to tell you our relationship, but he and I had built up a relationship over a length of time. And he came in and he sat across from me one day and I asked him, how are you doing? And he looked at me and he said, well, he said, I'm at a dilemma. He says, I quit dealing with drugs, I quit doing drugs. And he says, and in that short amount of time that I quit those things, my girlfriend has left me, she took my child, I have no money, I'm getting kicked out of my apartment, I'm losing my car, and it seems like the more I try to do what's right, the harder it gets. And he says, I'm questioning whether it's all worth it. Friends, some of us, we come to that point in life, don't we? We just say, is it worth it? Hezekiah never questioned that. He says, it is worth it. Because the reality is, sometimes life can be hard, but having God on your side always makes it easier, friends. May not always see it, may not always feel it, but it's there. You understand, Hezekiah trusted not only in the good times, but the hard times as well. Because trust is not based on our circumstances. Trust is based on the belief that God is working all things out for our good. Friends, we may not go through bad times. See, some people say, well, if I'm following God, everything ought to be good. Have you read the Bible? Jesus Christ, the Son of God, was placed on a cross. If He was placed on a cross, what can we expect? How should we be able to demand better than that? Any good that comes our way, we ought to praise God. But any bad that comes our way, we ought to praise God.
Amen.
Friends, the reality is, regardless of what comes our way, if God is with us, again, I ask, who can be against us? Hezekiah was devoted to God. He wouldn't turn away. Hezekiah realized that trusting in God is even more sacred than our wedding vows. You remember the wedding vows? A lot of us have taken them. For better, for worse, for rich, for poor, for sickness and health. Till death do us part, right? Now my wife, when she goes back, she says, my goodness, what did I do? You understand? She reconsiders that sometimes. And for some of us, we know, we say, well, I meant for better, for worse, but I didn't know it'd get this worse. And those type of things. But you understand the reality of that? We realize that we're saying, I love you, and nothing in this world will separate us. And as sacred as those vows are to our spouse, even more so, we should be devoted to God.
Right.
God, it doesn't matter what comes to me in life. I'm going to be devoted to you. One of my favorite stories in the Bible is Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They're told to bow down or they'll be cast into the fiery furnace.
Come on.
And those little boys, they stood up and everybody else bowed down. And the king said, bring them to me. And as they came up to the king said, boys, maybe you didn't understand. But I said, when the people plays, you bow down. Another chance. And they almost interrupt the king. And you know what they say? They say, King, there's no need to give us another chance because nothing's going to change. Said, our God, I love this, our God is able to deliver us. What can He deliver us from? Whatever you're suffering from, He can deliver you. But here's what they say, our God is able to deliver us. But even if He doesn't deliver us, let it be known that we will not worship you.
Amen.
They were getting ready to be tossed into a fiery furnace. But they had made a decision to follow God. To have faith in God. And I could almost give Austin just tell you what happened there in the fire. That was just something. That was dancing there. They got a little Pentecostal in the fire. Amen. That's all I'll say. There's some excitement there. But you realize they had devotion. Perhaps one of the greatest weaknesses for believers is seen in James chapter 1 verse 8. And it's a wavering faith. And it talks about a double-minded person. He's not sure. He's here one day and he's here the next. And it talks about how he's very unstable. And it talks about the instability that's there. Some of us have a crazy life because we can't make up our mind whether we trust God or not. We trust Him on Sundays, but do we trust Him Monday through Saturday? And friends, that's where Hezekiah was. Corrie ten Boom said, never be afraid to trust an unknown future to a known God.
Amen.
Friends, the most successful Christians are the ones who do not let their faithful walk with God go up and down with their circumstances.
Amen.
But rather, their faith is grounded in everything about trusting in God. That's where Hezekiah was. And friends, I spent a lot of time dealing with that and building that foundation because if you don't have that type of faith, if you don't have that type of trust, If you have not made that decision and have that devotion, you can't follow the rest of Hezekiah. It takes that decision, that devotion to see what happens. See, God does not turn, but God does allow threats. God does allow threats. He will allow threats to come into your life. 2 Kings chapter 18, looking in verse 17. If you were to go back for the sake of time tonight, we're not going to read all these verses. But if you were to start there in verse 17 and read all the way through the end of verse 25, you'll find out that Hezekiah and the nation of Judah has now been almost taken captive by Sennacherib. And his army here, about 185,000 soldiers, have surrounded Jerusalem. And they fortified themselves, ready to take the city siege, set a siege upon the city. They're ready to capture the city. And this is where they are. Now, you understand, Hezekiah, go back. It says, no man has been more faithful than Hezekiah. But yet Hezekiah is surrounded by the enemy. You see, just because we are faithful to God doesn't mean life is easy.
That's right.
And we see Hezekiah faces fighting. There's fighting there. In verses 17 and 18, it talks about the enemy coming upon him. But Hezekiah has done all the right things. He's reestablished. He's repented. He's repaired the temple. He's called the people back to the worship of God. And yet things still go bad. Friends, if they went bad for him, they're going to go bad for us. So the truth of the matter is, we are all in a place of storms. We're either in a storm, we've just come out of a storm, or bless your heart, you're about to go into a storm.
Right.
Storms are all throughout our lives. You can't escape them. They're going to be there. Hezekiah knows this. You realize that sometimes trusting God leads to greater challenges? The reality is, if you didn't trust God, if you didn't do it God's way, sometimes you would fly under the radar. Jesus even says that. The world doesn't like me, it won't like you. The world rejects me, it'll reject you. If you don't walk with Jesus, if you don't walk with God, sometimes life is a lot easier. God didn't promise it would be easy, but He promised He would never leave you nor forsake you. And this is where Hezekiah was. You understand, Hezekiah, he has a faith in God. And things are not great. Things are not perfect. But his faith allows him to keep going when others would have quit. Friends, the difference between you who trust in God and those who don't is that they will fall by the wayside long before you ever give up. And friends, if you truly are trusting in God, the reality is you'll never give up this side of heaven.
Amen.
When the going gets tough, the tough turn to God. That's where Hezekiah was. The fight we face, friends, defines the depth of our trust in God. You understand? You said, well, I've got this huge thing coming against me. Think about this. You know, we're in this springtime, March. I was walking outside the other day, and I was just like about to get in my car, and the wind just kind of picked me up and blew me away. It's just kind of like flag flapping in the wind. I was just kind of But you know what? The first thing that came to my mind, remember, I got young kids, and I said, I'm a big kid at heart. And I said, ooh, it's kite flying weather. And I said, I will fly a kite. And so I can't wait to do that. And I hope to do that soon, to fly a kite before the wind dies down. But do you understand the secret of flying a kite? The secret of flying a kite is not to put the kite in the wind. It's to put the kite against the wind.
Yeah.
If you put it in the wind, it simply falls down. It can't fly. It's when it's against the wind that it soars to its greatest heights. Friends, it's when we're cutting against the enemy and the power of God that we soar to our greatest heights.
Amen.
Hezekiah knew that. He was not faltered at all with the fighting that was coming upon him. But realize this. What I love about Hezekiah. Friends, do not belittle what he faced. 185,000 soldiers stood at the gate of Jerusalem. They had defeated every other person they had come into contact with. Jerusalem was no match for them. Hezekiah had one ally at this time, and that would have been Egypt. That would have been their strongest ally. And this army had already defeated Egypt. There was no one to call for help. Hezekiah has one option, God.
Right.
He puts all his apples in one basket. Because his only other option is to surrender, to give up. And I love it. Hezekiah won't do that. He says, God, not until you fail will I give up. Friends, if that is your motto, not until God, not until you fail will I ever give up, then my friend, you will always see victory.
Amen.
That's where Hezekiah was. He trusted that God's going to lead him to great victory. But you understand, he was facing failure. Everyone, again, as you go into verse 19 and through verse 25, they begin to, almost begin to celebrate the victories of Sennacherib and this army. And they talk about it. No one could defeat this army. Everyone had been defeated. All the other gods that had been brought out against this army had been defeated. No other god could stand against this army. Other leaders had called upon their gods for deliverance, and all those leaders had suffered defeat. Hezekiah looked, and he said this. He said, God, the only difference in Jerusalem and everybody else is you. You're the only difference. No other country, no other city, no other state has ever called upon you, God. They call on other gods, but not on you. You understand, there was something else at play here, too, that Hezekiah had to contend with. In the prophecies, it talked about how God would discipline the children of Israel. And it said he would use Assyria to do that. And so a lot of the leaders believed that when Hezekiah was going against this army, that this army was actually God's discipline upon the nation of Israel. So they basically had told Hezekiah, Hezekiah, don't even talk to God. Don't even worry about going to God. Simply because God is bringing this upon us. But Hezekiah believed that God would be with them. Friends, understand, everyone was telling Hezekiah, Hezekiah, it's not right for you to believe this. God wants us to suffer. But Hezekiah believed this. Hezekiah believed God loves me and God will be with me. Now, I like what happens. Sennacherib offers Hezekiah a compromise. He offers him a compromise. This world will offer you compromises.
Right.
And it will tell you, you don't have to fly so hard against the wind. Just go against it a little bit. Make it a little easier for you. Here's a compromise. Friends, so many churches today compromise. I love a statement I saw in the bulletin. It wasn't in this region. So don't think it was anybody around here. But I was in a church one day, and the bulletin said this. When you go in your small group classrooms today, greet each other as if they are your family, and hug and love on each other as if they are someone special. But make sure you do not leave valuables in the room. Kind of contradictory, isn't it? You know, when we send out messages like that, though, it's amazing how the world doesn't take us serious. Friends, you realize we contradict ourselves. Here's what Hezekiah did. He said, you know what? It may be God's judgment. But I believe God's going to be with me. And until God tells me otherwise, I'm going to trust that he's going to be with me. And I'm going to live as if he wants me to have victory. And I love that. God wants us to have victory, friends. You need to know that. God doesn't want you to have defeat. If you have defeat today, it's only to prepare you for greater victory tomorrow. And that's where God is. I'm not a prosperity preacher. I don't think that everything's all rosy. I think sometimes we go through cesspools sometimes. But you understand, I think that we go through those things so that we can get to the better things. And you see that through all the challenges that God's people face. It's better to trust in God than to compromise with the enemy. And that's what Hezekiah learns. So we see that God doesn't turn. He does allow threats. But the last thing I want you to see tonight is that God will make towers. Now, I want to clarify what I mean by this point because it may be a little confusing. When we look at people like Adrian Rogers, Jerry Vines, W.A. Criswell, D.L. Moody, Charles Spurgeon, we say those were towers for God. Those were oak trees for God. Those were great men of faith. You understand, they didn't make themselves that way. It was their trust and their faith in God that built them up that far.
Amen.
You understand, that's what it was. They were defined by their faith in God. The greatest men that have done the greatest things for God are the men that have the greatest faith in God. The women who have done amazing things, Annie Armstrong, Lonnie Moon, other women who have given their lives for the sake of Christ, did so because they believed in the power of Almighty God and they would not be turned away. But you understand, it It was not them that made themselves towers, but that God working in their lives that did it. Friends, God can make you a tower too. I want you to look very quickly as we go over 2 Kings. We jump over from Acts 18 now to chapter 19. And I want you to see what's going on there in verse 14, 15, 16 in that area. He's received a letter, basically, of compromise, a letter of threats from the enemy army. And look what Hezekiah does in verse 14, chapter 19, verse 14. Hezekiah took the letter from the hand of the messengers, read it, then went up to the Lord's temple and spread it out before the Lord. Friends, you understand? He read it, and then he ran to the house of God, and he places it on the altar, and he says, God, help us. God, help us. He takes his problem, and he lays it out before the Lord. He doesn't call his team and say, hey, guys, what do you think about this? He doesn't go and ask people's opinion. He sees it, and he takes it straight to God. How many times do we fail to take things straight to God? We take it to our mom, we take it to our dad, we take it to our children, we take it to somebody who has had more experience in these matters than us. And then eventually we say, well, I guess I'm just going to give it over to God. Aren't you a little late for that?
Yeah.
Friends, the very first person you ought to converse with is God.
Amen.
And he takes it and he lays it out before God. And he begins to just call on God and say, God, this is all you. You tell me what you want. You tell me what you need. And I love this. Hezekiah prays that God will defend. But notice what he asks God to defend. He doesn't say, God, defend us. God, defend me. He doesn't say, God, fight for me. I mean, that wouldn't necessarily be a bad thing because other men are calling God to fight for them and God says, I'm fighting for you. But that's not what Hezekiah does. You know what Hezekiah does? Again, remember, he has said the only thing different in us and every other country that's been defeated is you. So God, this is not about Jerusalem. This is not about Judah. This isn't about Hezekiah. God, this is about you. Because if they win, you lose. So God, I turn this over to you and I call on you, God, to defend your name.
Amen.
To defend your honor. Friends, let me tell you, that is a powerful prayer because the only way Hezekiah could truly have prayed that is if he was a man walking with God. Otherwise, it would have been hypocrisy to pray that. But he prays, God, defend your name. If we are to live lives that God has called us to live, when the enemy comes against us, we don't have to pray, God, defend us, God, protect us. We only have to say, God, defend your name. God, defend your honor because the life you're living is about him, not you. And that's where Hezekiah was. Hezekiah prays, God, defend your name. I love the story of Abraham Lincoln, another man, he was just a smart guy. Abraham Lincoln was told during the Civil War, some of these generals and leaders came up to him and said, President, Mr. President, we need to have a special day of prayer and fasting, asking God to be on our side. Wise Abraham Lincoln, he just shook his head. He says, no, we don't need to do that. He said, that's a waste of time. He said, we don't need to ask God to be on our side because God is already on the right side. Our job is to figure out which right side it is and to be on his side. Not asking him to be on our side, but for us to get on his side. And friends, that's what Hezekiah does. Hezekiah says, God, this is about you. Not about us. And God, I simply lift this up and I pray that you will deliver me. Friends, let me tell you this. God is all the difference you need in your life. God is all the difference you need. I don't care what you're facing. You're facing cancer? Wow. That's sad. And I don't mean to make it trivial. Please don't think I trivialize that. But let me tell you this, friends. I had a friend of mine a few years ago. She was so close to our family, we called her Nance. She wasn't really related, but that's how close she was. And when she got cancer, she told the nurses that she was going to be healed. And the nurses said, why do you think you're going to be healed? She said, why not? She said, I'm praying to God to ask him for healing. Well, when it got to the point in time, it was obvious she wasn't going to be healed, and more than likely, she was going to die pretty soon. One of the nurses came back to her, and she says, where's your faith now? And she says, oh, it's even better now than what it was before. And she said, what do you mean? And she said, well, I prayed that God would heal me. She said, but now in retrospect, I realize he didn't want me to stay in this world of corruption and sin anymore. He's ready for me to come home and spend eternity with him. Do you understand that when you are walking with God, the world can do its worst and it only allows God to do its best? There is absolutely nothing to fear. Nothing to worry about. Nothing to be discouraged about. Nothing to be depressed about if we're walking with God. Total, absolute faith and trust in God. Have faith in God because He will defend His name. I want to close with the last idea that Hezekiah, I believe, was very daring. In the closing verses, or at the meat of chapter 19, beginning there in verse 32, you begin to see what happens. Hezekiah's confidence will not go unrewarded. I love this. When people trust in God, God always delivers. He's better than dominoes, amen. He's never late. God always delivers. He delivers on His time, not always your time, but He will deliver. And understand this. When you go back and look at that for just a minute, I want you to see what he says. As he goes back now, remember, Hezekiah's been praying. He says, therefore, this is what the Lord says about the king of Assyria. Hear me, friends. Remember, this is the army of 185,000 that has sacked every city they've come upon. No one has even scuffed the leather of their boots. And here's what the Lord says. He will not enter this city. He will not shoot an arrow there. Now, you understand that? That makes it sound like for some of us who don't understand the historical idea there, the idea that arrows were going to come over, well, that means they were going to try to shoot a lot of arrows there. Now, what would happen is whenever they got ready to take a city, the commanding officer, which in this case would have been Sennacherib, would have taken a bow and arrow. He would have shot an arrow over the city wall, and that would have been signifying that he's taken the city, that the city is now his. And he says, that is not even going to happen. That's at the very beginning. That's before the fighting even begins. And he says, it's not going to happen. And he says, they will not enter this city. They will not shoot an arrow or come before it with a shield or build up an assault ramp against it. He will go back on the road that he came, and he will not enter this city. This is the Lord's declaration. Right. Friends, can you imagine what that felt like for Hezekiah to hear that? Because let me tell you something. Jesus has said that when you trust and put your faith in Him, the Holy Spirit has marked you. And you belong to Him. He says, all power has been given unto me. In heaven, under heaven, and around earth. Everywhere, all power is His. No one will come against you. No one will defeat you. Friends, you realize he didn't say there won't be enemies that face him, but they'll all be defeated. That's his promise to us. That's the word that we see. Friends, you understand, this enemy that was 185 soldiers strong had never been defeated, but God promised that victory to Hezekiah. And what is amazing is that Hezekiah doesn't even have to lift his finger. You understand, Hezekiah doesn't have to fight an army. Because he's already done his fighting with prayer. Right. We're going to talk a little bit later this week about prayer, but I want to tell you, friends, spending time with God is not a waste of time.
Amen.
Some people might have said, Hezekiah, you should have been down in the room preparing war plans. You should have been down with your generals planning. But he was with the general. He said, God, I trust you. Understand, God took care of everything. God slew them all. God slew them all. You understand? Sennacherib, in verse 37, you go back and read it. Sennacherib goes to the temple of a false god and he finds death. Hezekiah goes to the temple of a true god and he finds victory. Friends, remember when I said a while ago or earlier that it's all about a decision? Make sure you make the right one. A lot of people are like Sennacherib. They followed the road that looks good. Hezekiah's road didn't look good. He's surrounded by an enemy that's never been defeated, but he chose that path. And that was the path of victory. He trusted the word of God. Amen. Friends, I want to tell you, I close with this illustration. There was a little soup kitchen that would fill containers for people. And they knew it was going to be a cold winter, and so they were trying to fill it, and they knew that they didn't want to just give a meal for that day. So they'd ask people to bring something that could hold about 2 quarts worth of soup. And so that everybody was bringing their little quart containers and everything else. They were filling up and taking them home, so they'd have soup for that day and some more for later. And so they had all these things. Well, there was this young, dirty, slimy little boy came in, dragging behind him this 3-gallon container to be filled. Well, the people there in the soup kitchen, you realize there's a big difference between 2 quarts and 3 gallons. And this little boy had this 3 gallons worth of a container behind him. And the people at the soup kitchen, they looked and they said, "His container's too big." They said, "We're only filling it with 2 quarts." But the people, they talked and they said, "But he's brought a 3-gallon container. We can't let him go away with that mostly empty." So they gave him a whole lot more soup. Why? Because he came hoping for more. Friends, some of us, we approach God wanting the bare minimum. And that's all we have room for God to give us, is the bare minimum. God wants to give us so much more than we could ever imagine. Friends, let me ask you, how much are you asking God to give you? See, how much have you asked of God lately? When was the last time you really got serious and said, "God, here's what I need from you"? And you said, "Well, I'm not going to ask that." Well, why? Well, because that would be selfish. It's only selfish if it's about you. If it's about Him, it's not selfish. And God delights in that. Friends, let me ask you a question. Some of you are suffering right now tonight. Some of you have tried to make that turn of repentance. Remember, we're walking this way with the world, we repent and turn this way. Some of you have tried to do that. You're trying to choose God, but you realize that that road is rough, and you're saying, "I need help." Have you really asked God for help? Have you broken your heart and said, "God, I cannot do it, I have to have you. God, the only difference between defeat and victory for me is you"? Have you done that? Guess what? You get the opportunity to do that tonight. Are you coming to God with a 2-quart container? Or a 3, 4, 5-gallon container, saying, "God, fill me more than I could ever expect or ever hope for you to fill me"? God wants to do that. God wants to give us so much. They say in America that we are a rich country. I don't know if I believe that. I've been to other countries in this world, and I've seen God at work a whole lot greater than He is around here. So I have to question that maybe our perspective of what is rich and what is wealthy is a little skewed from what it should be. Friends, would you not join me tonight in asking God to bless us with His riches and His wealth? I just invite you to stand, and as you stand, I encourage you to bow your heads and just close your eyes. It's about trusting God. Do you trust God to take care of you? Do you trust God to meet your needs? Do you trust God to defend His name and your life against the enemy?